It's starting to do that. Okay, I'm going to share my screen. And I'm going to share the Can you guys see it?
I see a black screen right now.
Oh, can you see it?
Now I see your desktop.
Can you see the screens?
Now I see the slides.
Are you able to see the admission of the people, the list of people to admit?
No.
Okay. I don't know what I can do. But okay. Now I'm going to continue. Oh, shit. Enter. Okay. Hold on, guys. Invite. Let me go back. I'm just going to admit people. I guess I can't do both. Because I'm the host. I wonder if you could run this thing, but never mind. Let me just admit people. I'll start doing this and then. And then start sharing my screen, I guess.
We're still seeing your screen, but we're just seeing the desktop now.
Gary, did you study architecture?
Yes, sir. Yeah,
Alaska? I'm an
architect here in Anchorage. I studied in down in Missouri and then at the University of Oregon for my master's.
Right.
Yeah, and I'm part of a
practice in Alaska.
Yes, Yeah, we're about 24 people in our firm.
That's big. That's a big practice.
Guys, you know, I think we can hear you.
Yeah. Yeah, I can hear you too.
Okay.
should we not be chit-chatting?
I don't know. We're going to let it happen. I'm just trying to get everybody.
Okay. Yeah, for everybody that's joining, we're going to give it a couple minutes while we get everybody checked in, and then we'll get going here in just 1 or 2 minutes. Everybody that's joining the call here, we're going to give it about one more minute while we admit a couple more people, and then we'll get going with our intro. You want me to get started, Sue? I see you stopped your screen share.
Yeah, let me stop. All right. Yeah, get started.
Okay. Well, welcome everybody. I'm Garrett Bertner, a volunteer with the Alaska Design Forum here in Anchorage. And today we have Neil Durbach joining us from Sydney, Australia for the lecture. It's just after 8 in the morning tomorrow. So Neil's coming to us from the future. we are the Alaska Design Forum, or a nonprofit that exists to further the dialogue of design across the state of Alaska. And I want to thank everybody on the call and in our community for being part of that, that mission. This lecture today is part of the 2021 series titled Play, where our guests and programs are exploring the role of play in design. A couple quick announcements. We do have another talk upcoming in December. December 7th will be Chris Reed. He's a landscape architect. And if you'd like to keep track of our programs, you can go on alaskadesignforum.org and you can sign up for the mailing list there or see upcoming programs on the website. So today's program is brought to you free of charge. And that is due to the generous contributions of our sponsors. So I'd like to thank all of our sponsors, which we you can see on the website or we saw on the slides here at the beginning. So I have the distinct pleasure of welcoming Neil Durbach, architect, today to talk. I'm not going to try to give you his bio because he's going to tell us a little about himself when he starts, but I did want to share a little anecdote about how he came to be our guest here today. About 20 years ago before COVID, so 2019, November, I was in Australia helping lead a design tour for the Alaska Design Forum. And we were visiting architects and artists and designers in Sydney and Melbourne. And we were visiting with Dave Pegram, who is a faculty at the University of Technology in Sydney. And Dave was one of our alumni that came to Alaska to talk about his work a couple years prior. So Dave was giving us a tour of the campus there at UTS, and we toured into this new facility, education building, and it was just a really striking sculptural piece of architecture with beautiful color and light and texture. And, you know, we asked who the designers were, and he told me it was Durbach Block Jaggers. And I said, wow, this is great. I need to contact these guys for our lecture series. And then I forgot the name, of course, and then looked it up later and found their work and was just completely blown away. So super, super happy to have you here today, Neil. And thank you for joining us. And let's take it away. So I think if Sue, you could, or Neil, you can share screen.
Can share, okay.
Get away, sir.
Ready? Okay, can everybody see that? You can see that, Gary? Okay, cool. Thanks very much for asking me. It's actually an incredible privilege to be talking to you guys all the way over there. I'm going to talk for a reasonably short time, I hope, and it'll be really five projects. And after that, if there are any questions, that'll be great. Or if you want to interrupt while I'm showing slides, that's also cool. I sometimes start off by saying that I was born at the apex of the very point of the colossal and troubled continent of Africa. The sharpness of the contours of its geography echoed a very precise education. I say that we came to understand that everything the state taught us was bad was in fact actually quite good. The Beatles, Dylan, Karl Marx, other races, other creeds, other cultures, and television were all portrayed by this government as really awful. But we were taught at school not to believe them at all. I then like to point out that we all grew up with a really intense dislike of power and authority. I mention that, I sometimes wonder, did it eventually serve us well? Probably not, but there was nothing any of us could do about it. We were cooked that way. Sometimes I start off by talking about how I grew up in Cape Town, in a middle-class family, in a middle-class house, in a middle-class suburb. Sometimes I say that my mother, who was a journalist but wanted to be an artist, and my father was a businessman who really wanted to be a gardener. I then tell the story of how one day my mother suddenly painted the whole house pink and how my father retaliated by growing creepers all over it. And I say that's why I came to prefer white painted buildings. Sometimes I say that when I left school, I told my parents all I really wanted to be was Bob Dylan, and how they said, why don't you do medicine first and then you can be Bob Dylan. I tell the story of how, when I went to university to register for medicine, I saw that the queue for architecture was much, much shorter. And that is in fact how I became an architect.
Neil, but I grew to... sorry to interrupt, but we lost your images. We're seeing a black.
Yeah, it's just black.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you? But I grew to like architecture and then to love it. So we made many buildings, and some are dumb and some are ugly, but some of them I've become quite fond of. And one of them went on to become a kind of minor celebrity. But I'm wondering. The other day I was trying to explain the problem of architecture. So I did this painting. Here you can see that there's engineering on one side and interior design on the other. Now, engineering is mostly rational and interior design is mostly irrational. And everyone's kind of cool with that. But architecture is a bit of an unknown. It's squeezed uncomfortably between the two. It's seen as practically impractical by almost everyone. It's the ideal squeezed between the real. Architecture, to me, sometimes is like a tree. If we imagine that the architecture has roots that sink down into the earth, all the demands, requirements, and controls to do with shelter are established there. But sometimes this is as far as architecture gets. It's sort of just a practical stump, really just an ordinary building in a material world. But sometimes these base and basic practical things give rise to the branches and leaves and flowers that rise up to the sky. And these are the poetic and spiritual reaches of the architecture tree. It's all the things we discuss, delight in, laugh with, and wonder about. It's the way we see the world afresh each day. And all of this happens through architecture. I left South Africa for Australia in 1983. Arriving in Sydney, I was overwhelmed by two things: the Sydney Opera House and the actual geography of Sydney Harbour itself. I still get goosebumps looking at the Opera House. I think it's one of the most perfect of all buildings ever. It stands like other exceptional buildings, just beyond words. As the artist George Braque once said, words can explain everything about a work of art, except the one thing that really matters. In a sense, Australia feels like something tacked onto the back of the Sydney Opera House. It's kind of sad and it's kind of amusing that this building has had so little impact on the history of architecture in Australia. Maybe it's just too exceptional and nobody quite knows how to deal with that level of brilliance. There's a story, which is possibly true, that when the English colonialists arrived by ship in Sydney Harbour in 1788, the indigenous Aboriginals in their little canoes were totally unthreatened by the appearance of these giant and totally unimaginable fleet of objects. The explanation for this remarkable indifference was that these giant ships were so completely weird that they treated them like some sort of dreamlike apparition, and therefore probably didn't even exist. Some sort of figment of imagination that wasn't even worth talking about. And sometimes I think that's how Australians feel about the Sydney Opera House. The geography of the harbour is one of the most beautiful sights from the air. An impossibly gorgeous line of beauty that folds and snakes its way from the Sydney Harbour heads till it runs out of steam, almost 50 kilometers away. That curving, arching, looping line of coves and points, of headlands and bays, has become a continuous and inspiring image for our work. And I think it started to find its expression in one of our first built houses. The Holman House became one of our most published projects, but when we started designing it, we were totally unsure about how it would turn out or feel, or even how it could possibly get built. I think it was the time in our career when innocence and experience collided, how lack of knowledge and a desire to be experimental intersected. I sometimes think that given what we know now, it's unlikely that we would have ever designed something quite like it these days. From the street, the house is almost demure, rather plain. And this slow reveal is something I think that all our houses have in common. An interest in not being too interesting from the street. It's a game that we enjoy playing. But as you walk through the door, things start to shift gear. And suddenly you realize that the house is perched 70 meters above the sea and overhangs the cliff in two precarious places. One is perfectly level with the gliding seagulls. In the Holman house, everything seems to turn outwards, except for a circular courtyard, which looks inwards. And here are some images of the house. After the house was finished, somebody wanted to know what exactly was the inspiration for the house? Because I didn't really know how to answer that, I said, Picasso's Bathers. It's a painting by Picasso, and it looks like this. And because I'd always loved that the image looped and stretched and arced into the edges of the frame. And sometimes when you Google the Holman house, the Bathers shows up. And sometimes when you Google the Bathers, the Holman house shows up. Once we were even contacted by the Burberg exhibition place in Paris to see if we could include the Holman house as part of a Picasso show. About 10 years ago, we won a competition to design a house on a strange battle axe block in Point Piper. Here's an image of the site. It's the little red dot there. And you can see it's sort of this site that was off the road, but it was potentially right on the harbor. So you can sort of, I don't know if you can see here, can you see this here? And you had to walk along, come down and get into the house that way. Sorry, just let me clear that. Okay. Ugh. I shouldn't have drawn there. Sorry, guys. Okay, sorry. The first thing that we did was to move the house forward off the cliff and down onto the beach. So you can sort of see here how we had to come in off the street. You come down a lift, you go through this tunnel. So it's actually a piece of infrastructure, and that you head into the house through this 20 meter long or 30 meter long tunnel, and it's only 2 meters wide. There you can sort of see an image of how you had to get to the house. That's the view from the garage. And that's the roof garden. So this is the 2 meter wide entry hall, which is like 7 meters high. At some point we had to almost come up with an image of the house itself. And we developed this little drawing to show the client. We said it's like this sort of beach washed pebble. Just perched very delicately on a site. So it was this idea of this incredibly heavy object, improbably supported on very fine columns. And that's the house. And these are some images of it. In Sydney, everybody tries to maximize the views of the harbor. But what we quite liked in this house is that we said to the client, it'd be kind of interesting for us if the views were very curated and cinematic. And he was interested in that idea. And we showed him this image of Villa Malaparte, which has always been one of our most incredibly favorite houses, and how they sort of just had very specific curated views. The whole building didn't open up. And we went to visit this house in maybe 3 years ago, and it was an incredible thing to see it. So we sort of, here's some of the views from the house looking into the harbor. And so it was very cinematic that each time you saw something very specific that we wanted, it wasn't this generic view of seeing things. I also thought, I loved this quote by Borges where he said, I thought of it, of the house as a maze of mazes, of an ever-growing maze, which would take in the past and the future and would involve the stars. Here's some more images of the house. We do like the idea that sometimes you can get lost in a place and that houses allow for this incredible complexity, unlike many public or bigger buildings. And the last thing that we had in this house was the client was an avid swimmer, and we had to build a pool that was 16.66 meters long, so he could do 3 laps to get 50 meters, and that pool extended out into the harbor, and you sort of swam from inside the house towards the harbor each time. The final thing is, this also a quote by Borges, where he loved the idea that a house could become so complex that people got lost in it. And he said that was more unusual for him than that of a man with a bull's head. For me, architecture uses beauty as a means to escape the dreary drudge of our lives, to see the poetry of architecture as the light at the end of the tunnel or the silver lining in a cloud. Wilhelm Voringer said that we all grow up with something missing inside us. And it's these imbalances that determine what's going to appeal to us and what's going to turn us off. Waringer said that people who are calm and cautious and rigid will be drawn to passionate and dramatic art. But people who are already over anxious and over excitable will be drawn to work that is calm and logical. He said, we use art to compensate for our own shortcomings. Waringer said that in the end, what we find beautiful are indications of what we need in order to become properly whole. Most beauty is based, I believe, on the sentiment that sometimes it's a total hassle being a human being, but here in art is an offering that will help you forget that. As Stendhal once said, beauty is the promise of happiness. The soul has more need for the ideal than it does for the real. This is Nikki's house in Tamarama. Every neighbor in this street dislikes each other. It's an incredibly disputed territory. And maybe that's because it's such an exceptional place to live. Although the streetscape is really quite dull, the beach itself on the other side of that street is incredibly fabulous. But sometimes when the southerly blows, like here, it can be awful. And this is a real picture. Sometimes that's how strong the wind is. So the first move was to break with the existing pattern where people seem to build the whole site and to move the house towards the water to make a north-facing, wind-free, protected, sunny courtyard. In this house, we explored many, many options. You can see these are some of the models that we made to explore options for the house. Some more models at a bigger scale. And we explored 3 different types of overlapping geometries. It was low and wide on the street and high and thin on the beach. And in the middle was the sort of maze-like condition. This is the, and here's some pictures of the house. That's the house from the street. But then as you walk in, you start to get glimpses of the water. That's the north-facing courtyard where you can see straight through to the water. And I'll just take you on a quick tour of this house. So it was very dark when you entered. There was this very bright stairwell that led up to the bedrooms and this amazing spiral stair that sort of twisted all the way down into the garden level. Sometimes I think that the real difference between a house and a bigger project is that in a house you get to explore and experiment with the language of architecture itself, to engage with the complex and unique pleasures of turning air into space and spaces into places. In the way that Corbusier used paintings to invent new ways to think about buildings, we use houses to think about new ways to make bigger projects. And in the end, the very last thing that we designed for the house was this particularly peculiar element. It's neither really a handrail nor a pool barrier, but rather a kind of final courtesy in steel. In our small studio, we've never really been interested in excess or waste or flabbiness. When I was a kid, we never really wondered how much money the Beatles had or how rich Bob Dylan was. In fact, we just assumed they were like us, except they were talented beyond belief. And although we sometimes do design for the privileged few, I'm proud to say that I live in a one-bedroom apartment that I fiddle about with every now and then. It has a wonderful, crazy roof garden that's the size of the apartment too. Our office runs pretty lean, always has, and has worked very hard not to take on work that is unlovable. There is a huge amount of freedom, we think, in keeping the office small. It means that we all draw and document and answer the phone too. I still marvel at the fact that Corbusier, who was working on remaking parts of India at the time, lived in the same apartment overlooking a stadium for his whole life. His only extravagance seemed to be this cabin of his in Roquebrune, which we visited. He built it next to a small beachside restaurant, so he didn't need a kitchen. He slept on the floor so the single bed could be used by his wife, and the whole thing seemed to combine optimism and openness. Large patterns and unpredictable particulars. He seemed to embrace the slapdash, a carefree spirit permeates the site and its holiday house. It seems so convincing and so crude. It's a magical quality only a passionate amateur can possess. Some things in it, God forbid, were even left to luck. Well, that's how it seems. You know, when you visit his buildings, they seem so casual, so lyrical, so loopy. But when you actually look at the plans, they are so austere, really. The absolute minimum of curved geometry seems to permeate the whole building. It's the hardest working curve. Sometimes it's a really great exercise to look at a project in a way as if you try to do your own and often inadequate version of somebody else's ideas. Now, this isn't a new idea at all. More often than not, Picasso looked at the masters and then he did his own version of their work, like in this version of Las Meninas by Velázquez and Picasso. He takes the painting as an extraordinarily rich and complex work, and then Picasso does his own interpretation of it. It's obviously not a copy, but in a sense, it's his own reworking of it. Van Gogh did the same thing. When it was winter in Ireland, he couldn't go outdoors. He reworked some of his favorite artists. And recently, of course, David Hockney did the same thing to Van Gogh. This is part of my library at home. All these books are physical parts of my memory of architecture. These are our precious precedents. Our studio deliberately and consciously stands on the shoulders of giants. In 1159, John wrote in the Metallogicon that Bernard of Chartres used to compare us to dwarves perched on the shoulders of giants. He pointed out that we see more and further than our predecessors, not because we have a keener vision or greater height, but because we are lifted up and borne aloft on their gigantic stature. I truly believe that original work has all architecture rolled up into itself. I think that when we experience deeply the work of Corbusier, we're experiencing him looking at all architectures. And I believe that's the real reason that his work feels permanently present and vivid and infinitely wonderful. I've always been fascinated by this sketch that Jean Utzon did of the Opera House. He called it a cloud floating over a plateau, and it's the most evocative image. In the house at Lavender Bay, we try to reinterpret the image of Utzon's. A cloud floats over a Sydney sandstone block, and this solid piece of stone is internally eroded and carved as if water had percolated through it for thousands of years. The roof is a vast arched space that spans 45 feet with the tiniest possible columns. So here you can see some model studies of it. And here's some images of the house. So that's the entry court. So that's all Sydney stone. And here's the idea that you sort of have this eroded interior that seems, and then you rise up through it and you can see the roof, the ceiling floating over this whole building. And the really cool thing is that looking from within this room, both the Harbour Bridge and the Sydney Opera House itself are framed. Recently, we finished a project in Chippendale. It's for a performance space and a gallery for the arts philanthropist and patron Judith Nielsen. We did this project in collaboration with our good friend John Wardle. He did the gallery. We were left to do the performance space. We had absolutely no idea what a performance space really was. So we said to Kai, who was our coordinator in chief, can it just be a simple black box? Because we thought that was all that was needed for a performance space. And secondly, because we are feeling a little architecturally exhausted and drained. You all know that feeling. And Kai said, if all I wanted was a simple black box, I could have got my accountant to design it. In 1570, 530 years ago, somebody brilliant came up with this design for the Inyard Theatre. And about 30 years later, the Magnificent Globe Theatre was built. And because we'd really always loved that design, we said then and there that this sense of aroundness was so beautiful that this would be something that we should explore in this project. And we did. I won't bore you with how we struggled and strived, but in the end, we came up with a plan. So on the right is John's gallery. In the middle, there's a courtyard space, which we both designed. And on the left is our space. It's simply one room. It's a theater without drama. It's free from extravagant loops and voids. And our room is only 11 meters by 12 meters by 11 meters. It's almost a perfect cube. And this cube contains two spirals. A slow ramping spiral down, contrasting and almost touching the back to front stair. It's a nod to Corbusier's ramp and stair, prancing around each other at the Villa Savoy. And surrounding the floor of the theater is a timber spiraling enclosure that rises up, turning and twisting and descending till it loses control near its own ceiling, trying to escape through the tiniest skylight we have ever done. I imagine it as an improbable timber curtain unfurled inside a gray brick cave. I've never really been into buildings that show too much from the outside, and I've always preferred a building that projected a sense of, there's almost nothing to see here, just move on. This painting by Hieronymus Bosch is a perfect example of what I mean. The Garden of Earthly Delights, I'm sure all of you know it. The wildly exuberant, strange and colorfully perplexing objects, a visceral world from creation through fantastical gardens and people to representations of hell itself. But the really wonderful aspect of this painting is this part, the two outer panels that actually fold over and conceal this delirium. So the painting, you can see that the two outside panels fold to create this image. And it depicts for Bosch the creation of the world when greenery was just starting to close this pristine orb. From the street, our building is monolithic. It's just a tall wall, two windows, two eyes glimmer, two possibilities. A golden window suggests the deep space of the theater, and above to the right, a cloud-like window recalls the rooftop garden, and that's really all there is to it from outside. Otherwise, a stillness, a pause, a break in the visual traffic. A gray and pale green, almost bland external skin highlights the vivid interior, because external appearances and internal experiences should not be the same thing. Here's some images of that theater. I love to believe that everyone, no matter how cool or how politicized they might be, is into architecture as a transcendent experience. I could be wrong, but I don't think so. Picasso famously said that art washes away from the soul the dust of everyday life. An architecture that is transcendent achieves that kind of ecstatic condition. Your imagination is set alight and your soul is set free. You know, some people confuse bigness with greatness, and some people confuse cuteness with beauty. Some people make you feel oh so small, and some people make you believe that you're way too big. But beauty resides, I think, in the careful collaboration of both. Our mind leaps back and forth between the intimate and the vast. And it's that moving back and forth that engages us. And as far as I can tell, that's what makes beauty beautiful. Palladio had the uncanny ability to expand the spaces to the warm outer edges of enclosure. His rooms hypnotize us. They seem uncanny, enchanting. There's something about them that makes them a magical artifact. He understood more than anyone I know that the perfect harmony of big and small led to a hallowed state of intimate grandeur. In Villa Rotunda shown here, he knew how big was too big and how wide was too wide, and he kind of nailed it. When we were designing the theater room, we looked at the dimensions of some of the best rooms ever created. Ronchamp by Korb in 1960, San Ivo by Borromini in 1660. Both transcendent spaces, halfway to heaven. And I wondered, how on earth did Palladio himself create the essence of intimate grandeur? How did he create such perfect rooms? David Hickey, a while ago, wrote this most beautiful observation about Palladium. If you bear with me, I'd like to quote part of it. This is a Palladio who makes sense, I think, a Palladio possessed of what we used to call the George Clooney thing, the magical ability to play the role and sing the song while deftly communicating that as lovely and as powerful as the role and the song might be, the role is just a role, the song is just a song, and the singer is no Orpheus, just another tradesman lively at his work. This trick, which is not really a trick at all, but the attribute of a generous personality, explains why Palladio buildings are never quite as intimidating as their clients might have wished them to be, why their aspirations to exquisite grandeur always bear with them the glimmer of a smile. This aura of sweet self-consciousness is, for me, according to Hickey, the key to Palladio's charm. Viewed in this light, the distance we feel between the exquisite form of his buildings and their function seems less critical or ironic than joyfully self-aware. So now it's really the end of my little talk. And although I would never really admit this publicly, I've actually always been fascinated by magic and magicians. It's a crazy game of trying to understand what is seen as well as how it's seen. Picasso did this here, for he took a bicycle saddle and some handlebars, and he saw a bull's head, and that's the Picasso in Picasso. As architects, we take bits of stone and timber and pieces of steel and glass, and just by using numbers, we create our own magic, our own atmospheres, our own volumes, our own places of mystery, and our own places of happiness. And voila. And now that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Neil. That was fantastic. I do have a few questions for Neil, and then we can take some questions from the chat. So this first one is maybe a little strange. As I looked through your work on your website and other places, I was so overwhelmed by so many beautiful surfaces and, you know, textures and spaces. And it occurred to me that the longer I'm in the world of design, the longer I practice and the longer I travel and experience things, the more passionate I get about beautiful things. And I wonder if you ever get exhausted by the amount of beauty that is in your own practice and your life, and what you do to cope with that feeling.
Yeah, I think it's such a hard thing to achieve, and it's such an elusive thing to achieve. And it's one of the things that actually drives us on, because I think we always feel that we never really come up to the levels of the people we admire, and that kind of infuriates us and inspires us. And so I think we always feel incomplete, and that one day we'll be as good as Corb or as Palladio, but you know, obviously, because we'll never get there, we just keeps driving us.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that makes sense.
Sure. Yeah. This sort of a dialogue with your heroes is something that is ongoing throughout your life. But so the second question is more about the people that build your projects. There's so much craft evident in these projects. Do you have any favorite craftspeople or any anecdotes about the craftspeople that have worked on your projects that you can share with us?
You know, I think every project in a sense you work with a new team, and there's always that that moment in every project when something clicks, and I think everybody kind of gets what we're trying to do or achieve together. And actually, that's a lot of coercing and begging and pleading and encouraging. But there's always that moment when everybody goes, oh, okay, so that's what we're trying to do. And then there's this sort of sense of, you know, this amazing collaboration or this collective effort to make something that's out of the ordinary. And and I think once you get people to realize that they're part of that process, it's pretty easy after that. But we work really hard on site. I mean, when we build, we sort of on site, you know, every other day, actually.
So it's not that you have one amazing brick mason that you always work with for decades. It's not like Carlo Scarpa walking down the streets in Venice and talking to the, you know, the metal workers and the,
I think the realities these days, the economic realities, that you often get pretty ordinary builders or pretty bad builders often. And within that, you've got to find the people that you can connect with. But I don't think there's the luxury anymore of just saying, I only work with these people or these tradesmen or these artisans.
Right. So on the topic of play, since this is the play lecture series, there is some what you might call playful elements, of course, to your work. But I read in another interview that you gave that you prefer to think of it as serious play. And I guess what I'd like you to tell us is how that plays out in your practice. So like a day in the life at Durbach Block Jaggers, what's the serious play look like?
You know, the thing is, Camilla Block and Dave Jaggers and I, and a lot of the office have been together. I mean, Camilla, Dave and I have been together for 30 years. And part of that is that we find each other amusing. And I think everybody feels that they're funnier and more entertaining at work than they probably are in real life, because they sort of encourage to think creatively and to think outside the box and to take. And it's an atmosphere where we very seldom say no. I think it's, we always say yes first, try it out. And if it's a failure, we just go, well, we just keep moving on. And I think that's the sort of playful side. But the other side of that is that there's this incredibly deep knowledge and love of architecture and its rules and its language. And I think because we, the three of us, have this understanding of those rules and the sort of language of architecture, that liberates us. Because I think you're always playing within these amazing rules that have created extraordinary buildings that you see all the time. And you think, you know, Utzon worked with rules as well, but somehow and so did Korb. You know, that's what I was trying to say, is that they understand architecture so deeply, the rules of architecture, that allows them to play. And I think the idea that for us has always been that the deep knowledge of architecture is the most liberating element that you can ever, and we try and encourage that in our people we work with always. Like, you have to look. You know, Corbusier had this thing that the eyes that see, but that, or the eyes that look but don't actually see. And I think we say you have to be able to get beyond the Google image. Like, you've got to sort of figure out what's behind that to understand it. And I think that makes it more playful for everybody, that you're not just dealing with the surface of things, but you've gone into it and you're in this sort of Alice in Wonderland world of things.
Right.
I don't know if that makes sense.
It does. Yeah. It's interesting that you characterize that deep knowledge and how that, you know, plays into your process, because when I was, you know, looking at the work, I don't take this the wrong way, but I perceived it as kind of didactic. Like, I could look at one of these projects and I could extract all the principles of design and architecture out of these images. knowing that history, knowing those things, but you know, it's almost like a primer for a certain narrative about the history of architecture contained in one mm-hmm. thing. It's very that's very true. Pleasing, at least to me.
It's true. I think it's in a way, as what you've just said is true, that you're trying to always show people, you know, that you're always working within the language of architecture, and you sort of, they're quite sort of sly references, not in a mean way, but just to say, hey, did you think about it? We've seen how they did it, but this is our version of it. And I think that's the game that you are playing, is that you know, we're not, as I said, I think being original is thinking about the origins of things. And I think there's this kind of weird thing these days where to be original is that it all happens just magically. But actually being original is actually, it's a deeply studied way of thinking about the world.
Sure. So I'll ask one more question and then I'll take some chat questions. And this one is about drawing. Obviously you have a personal relationship with drawing and a love of drawing. How would you describe that, and in your own life and in your practice, your relationship to drawing as a practice, and what tools do you like to use?
Well, most mornings the office has come to sort of deal with this. I sort of sketch at home with watercolors until about 10 or 11, pretty well every day. And I've always loved the feel of pencil on paper. There's something physical, and I love watercolors especially. But I think Paul Klee, the artist, called it the thinking eye. And sometimes, and I think Glenn Merkert, who you've met, also talks about this, that sometimes your hand is the best way of thinking. And actually, if you just let it kind of wander around the page on its own, without sort of trying to control or train it, you know, it sort of comes up with things and you think, well, that's kind of interesting. I hadn't really thought about that, but well done, hand, you know. Let's see where that goes. And I think Rem Koolhaas said the same thing, that if you can suspend judgment, and I think drawing, there is very little judgment in drawing. It's just this, you know, it's this kind of reverie. You're just doing things. The suspension of judgment allows all sorts of things to happen. Like there's a multiplicity of options suddenly emerge. But the minute you try and control it, and you're trying to sort of use your rational mind to control and determine what happens next, you kind of lose that. Those sort of, you know, weird shifts and changes of direction and misreadings and mistakes and all that sort of thing. And mm-hmm. which often lead to the more interesting options.
Yeah, it's remarkable how a tiny freehand sketch line drawing can, the essence of that can carry through into a, you know, a construction, a final mm-hmm. construction. Well, it's so fun to talk to you. I'm going to see if there's any chat questions. It looks like somebody asked, Todd Young asks if you've ever designed any buildings in Cape Town.
Not really. I left Cape Town pretty soon. I actually went to study at Berkeley before coming to Australia. So I sort of was really just a student.
Mm-hmm. And you haven't revisited or no. As a professional. Yeah. Okay, let's see. Ben, this is a question. Yeah, Ben Ferry says, well, you can see these two, but I'll read it for everybody. Concrete can be a funny thing. Some people love it, some people hate it. With being such a massive and heavy material, how has concrete played an influence with the sense of play? If you had to redesign some of those projects, would you still use concrete?
You know, concrete now has a very bad rep, as you know. But I think the one project that you refer to was designed 10 years ago when we were more stupid about the bad aspects of concrete. But the one thing I do love about concrete is that it's a liquid material, and that it's frozen at some particular point. And I think that freezing allows you to keep pushing it until it settles. But I love the idea that it's this incredibly plastic material that you solidify at some point and you say, that's it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think sometimes we say to each other as an excuse, well, at least it'll last 100 years and maybe that's sustainable in itself. But I mean, I think we've now moved away from using a lot of concrete.
Yeah, you showed that quick image of that Frank Gehry project on UTS. I think the word that went with was bloated and kind of funny, but you know, there's a lot of form making there that is done with is constructed with steel framing.
Yes.
And I don't know, there's maybe some fundamental difference in the experience of something when you can tell that it's kind of an armature that holds a skin versus something that is actually substantial, has the substance of a mass.
I mean, I think that's a really interesting thing, because I think, I mean, as you know, and the sort of rain screen or that they now call it, allows for all these kind of loopy, goofy kind of shapes. But we've just finished a competition for the National Gallery of Victoria, just finished. And part of that was, how do you make the skin integrated? So it's not something that the client at some point says, you know, guys, we can't really afford the rain screen. Just let's get rid of it. And all you're left with is this, oh my God, is that it? And I sometimes do, as brilliant as Gehry is, I sometimes, you know, every single brick was support in that project was supported individually. And I think, I just think that's kind of excessive, you know, for me. I think we have to be more resourceful and things have to be more integrated than just this decorative veil that sort of just you can do whatever with, and then behind it is some sort of piece of nonsense. Anyway, that's just my own view. I don't know if that's the smart thing to say, but
it's just part of the dialogue. anyone else? We got a couple minutes. Are there any other questions from folks? If anyone wants to, we got one here from Peter. Diversity and equity within the design professions is a topic at our forefront. With goals such as having a future diversity of professionals that better reflects the communities we live in, what is the state of this conversation and action in Australia?
In Australia, it's a huge thing now, and rightly so. I mean, our office actually has always encouraged, you know, Camilla is an equal partner and actually represents the firm more than I do now. She's a much better talker in many ways. But I think I think this sort of male-dominated thing is something that was never that interesting for our office. And we actually do have 50-50 pretty well in our office now. And we do encourage collaborating, and we have to collaborate with many people across all creeds and cultures and interests. And that's something in Australia that is taken really seriously, strangely enough, given that the government doesn't seem to be heading in that direction. But at the state level, and at the professional level, that's a super important thing. And everybody benefits from it. I think working with Indigenous Australians is now a crucial part of every project. Crucial. You won't even get a look in if you don't have Indigenous, Aboriginal architects, artists, landscapers, engineers, etc., working with you. You know, they just won't even consider that.
Yeah. My impression on visiting was that the inclusion and recognition of Aboriginal culture and people was quite a bit ahead of where we're at, at least in Alaska or in the States. But That dialogue has, you know, is certainly underway in Alaska and has been, but it's more prevalent there. So it was encouraging.
And it's not token either. That's the sort of cool thing, is that there's this incredible, I mean, you would have met Glenn. I don't know if you met Rick Laplastri and all that, but there's for like the last 30 or 40 years, everybody's been in the architectural community, at least, been talking about the benefits of their deep understanding of place.
Mm-hmm. Peter follows up, not just diversity of stakeholders, but assisting with bringing them into our professions. So I guess maybe in your roles as educators or in your roles with the universities, are you seeing that as well? More work on equity in the profession?
I think so. I mean, I've sort of stopped teaching now, but mm-hmm. I think there's the you know, there is a huge commitment across the board to not to make a tokenistic thing, but to make it a genuine, positive, collaborative. Yep.
Okay. Well, all right. I wish we could have lunch together or breakfast, brunch. Right. But we'll let you go to your work and we'll go to ours. And it's been just a delight to meet you, and hopefully next time in person.
We'll be great.
Come on up here. Or we'll look you up next time we come down under.
All right. And thanks for having me. It was fantastic.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Karen. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody.